Well, it gives me great pleasure today to welcome Robert Hinshelwood and my helper to a THERIP interview. I've known Robert Hinshelwood, of course, for many years. He is a leading noted Kleinian analyst. He wrote an excellent book, a sort of dictionary of psychoanalysis of Kleinian terms, which I use frequently in teaching. And he has a particular interest in history, and he was the founder or one of the co-founders of a journal called Psychoanalysis and History. It's therefore particularly appropriate that he has chosen as his interview an oral historian, Mike Roper. And although I don't know his work, I'm very interested in the oral history approach, being an anthropologist myself, and I'm looking forward very much to what they have to say.
Well, let's start. When were you born? And where?
I was born in 1938. I'm a pre-war baby, just about, in London, in South London. My parents had set up home in Sutton, in South London.
What did your father do, and your mother?
They were both civil servants. My mother, of course, only until she married, because in those days married women couldn't be civil servants, but they met sort of through some social occasion to do with their work, civil service. They were civil servants,
right.
And my father continued as a civil servant. Right, I think he had 42 years of service as a bureaucrat, which has left me with complex feelings about bureaucracy.
So he bought your work home in a funny way. Then tell me about how it is that you turned to medicine. With your school, and what were you interested in? And where did you go to school?
I went to the local grammar school. First person, really, I think, in my family to pass the 11 plus exam and go to a grammar school. Well, I think perhaps my mother went to a grammar school briefly, but it wasn't quite the same institution in her day. Grammar school was really a big thing to get your child into the grammar school. From my background, was quite an achievement for the family.
And did you have brothers and sisters?
I had a brother, yes, and I had a cousin who was closely brought up quite closely at the time. Neither of them.
Okay, so you were the only one in the family then to have.
Well, I was also a prize specimen as far as the family was concerned, like that, yes.
What do you mean?
Well, the achievement, the academic achievement at school. I think my father came from a working class background, from an aspiring working class family where the values were to advance oneself, and in those days education was one of the ways to advance, or main way for working class people to advance themselves. And my father left school at 14 with virtually no education, and got himself some education through the Workers' Education Authority, which was a movement in the 1920s, where aspiring people like my father were able to advance themselves. And, you know, he did through solid, hard work. They just said drudgery, but that was his attitude.
So
hard, determined work life was.
And so you're, what about medicine then? Where was the, at what point in your schooling did you begin to think that this would be what you'd do?
Well, You see, it was never what I thought I would do, because I had no idea what doctors did. It just wasn't part of my background or my family, and no one in the family was a doctor. It was just one of the routes. If you did biology at A level in those days, medicine was one of the possibilities. And I don't quite know how I happened to go into medicine. There were other people in my sort of year at grammar school, a couple of people who were the children of doctors, but I wasn't particularly friendly with them. I don't know how I came. It was just one of the possibilities. And at that time, the 1940s, 1950s, you know, children went through a channel, or at least this is my experience. You went through a channel, you did what you had to do at school, and then you did what you had to do in life, and it was a bit programmatic.
Some things seem to have been made for you in some way at that point. And what about, at the point at which you decided psychiatry is what you want to do?
Well, that was later on in my medical training. I was interested in psychiatry when I did my 3 months on the psychiatric wards. I thought peculiar people were rather interesting.
And this was in your part of general medical
school? Yeah, that's in that medical school, yes. Yes.
So what was it about that experience? Do you have any memories of what that was like?
It was a mixture of sort of teenage amusement at strange people and a sort of ghastly realization of something inexplicable was happening to such people who saw on the walls dreaming mad delusions and saying mad utterances. So I think it was a pretty mixed sort of experience, and I was had a very close friend at the time. We both shared a lot of these kind of mixed feelings, a way of trying to manage the experience. And medical school was a prolonged stint of managing dreadful experiences. You know, the first day you go to, second day you go to medical school, the whole cohort is ushered into the dissecting room where there are these tables of dead bodies, and you're assigned 6 to a body, and you then go out and buy your scalpels and things, and you come back for the next anatomy session. And you look at each other, the 6 of you around the table, and who is going to be the first person to take their scalpel and make a cut in this thing, which is a body, or is it a person, or what it is. It's, it's a shattering experience. And I think doctors never get over it. It's why they're such emotional, stultified people. I think one of the experiences which enables doctors to become slightly emotionally walled off in their professional lives. I must say, going straight from school to university in the 1950s, one was pretty green about all sorts of things. This is the first time I'd seen a naked female body. It was the dead body.
The first time you'd seen a naked female body was a dead body.
Was the dead body. Mm. So I think medical school was that kind of emotional obstacle course from beginning to end. And psychiatry, perhaps I got psychiatry. We sort of learnt to mediate it a bit with humour. But I did take quite an interest in psychiatry, partly because the psychiatrists at the University College were particularly inspiring people, I suppose. You know, people are terribly influenced by their teachers. And there was a man there called Roger Treadgold, who was really quite well known. who was a very inspiring lecturer and took an interest, a paternal interest in all these students.
Sorry, what was he teaching?
This is psychiatry. So this was an influence in going in that direction, I guess. And there were other people who I came across, a man called Heinz Wolf, who was at the time a very well-known psychotherapist, and extremely charismatic, and who also influenced a lot of people to go into psychiatry. And at the time that I was at UCH, there were a whole raft of people who became psychiatrists, mostly psychiatrists. Psychiatry in those days picked up a sort of people who weren't going to go anywhere in medicine, general medicine or surgery. But from UCH, I think there was a positive interest, you know, the more talented people. Should I include myself? I don't know. either the more talented people or the people who are more worried about themselves and their own mental health, and I think that applied to me as well. so that was probably the other reason why I became a psychiatrist, is that I wanted to know a bit more about my peculiar quirks and the unhappinesses in my life. I didn't do particularly well. Well, it may be relevant for my later academic career, but in those days, in the middle of medical training, before you went on to the clinical part of the training, after the academic part of the training, you could do an extra year, what's called an intercalated Bachelor of Science, which I did, and thoroughly enjoyed this year of academic interest, which was in the anatomy department at University College, where I came across another very charismatic man, a man called Jason Young, very well known in those days. He was interested in the anatomy of the brain and nervous system, and was counts as one of the early pioneers in neuroscience from the 40s and 50s. He was a major academic in his early life, again influenced by these paternal figures. Looking back, I can say I had a sort of father transference going from pretty early on.
And what about the interest in psychoanalysis? Because I presume that that isn't what many psychiatrists end up being interested in. What point did that begin to emerge as an interest for you?
Once I got into psychiatry, after qualification as a doctor, you have to do your year's stint in medicine and surgery, 6 months of each, which I cleared off out of London to do, and then I came back to do psychiatry, and I got a job at University College as a senior house officer for a year. And this was in the mid-60s, at a time when something called anti-psychiatry was just taking off and beginning to blossom and bloom. explode, maybe. Bad analogy. And I got quite interested in, there must be some alternative to keeping these poor people in this highly oppressed fashion. And here was somebody who came along, Ronnie Yet Lang, also David Cooper, Ronnie Lang was one of the big name, saying, well, it's not really that they're mad, it's that the rest of society is mad. It's all the mad people who are really the same ones. For somebody to worry about himself, that was perhaps quite good news. So I took, I got quite interested in that kind of movement, which was centered around Ronnie Lang, but also psychotherapy and psychoanalysis, the engagement with patients, rather than the more mechanistic attitude and practice of psychiatry. At that point, you see, in the 60s, there was big medical headlines in the news about the wonder drugs. Antibiotics had come in the 40s. The psychiatric wonder drugs were Gactil in, I think it was 56 or 57. So there was this big white hope that people would be normalized to these mechanical, chemical methods.
But you're reacting against that trend in some sort of way.
Yes.
Could you say a bit more about what your interest in psychoanalysis was, or where did it come from? You're saying you're evolving the psychiatry movement, but was it from reading? Was it from, where were you getting it from at that point? What point did your analysis begin?
I suppose I read about it for quite a long time. And this is a long time ago. When I left school, and before I went to medical school, I remember picking up a book by Jung. Must have been his Memories, Dreams and Reflections, his own autobiography, which I took on holiday reading, and read about this extraordinary way of looking at people. People. Well, you see, I've told you I was brought up by bureaucrats. The bureaucratic method is you follow programs and regulations. And the man was talking about people had quite different. They had feelings and introverted and extroverted. You could think about people and what they were like as people, and they had traits and characteristics and hopes and dreams and things, which was an extraordinary kind of eye-opening experience. So I can say that I was set on a particular path of trying to think differently from my background. Well, perhaps late on in my schooling, you know, I remember, and it fits slightly, I remember as a late teenager that endless frequent, recurrent experience of discovering a whole new door opening into a set of ideas or imaginings, of new literature to read, but also art and science itself. And I remember from time to time in my soulful adolescent way, I'd go to the public library and just look at the section where they had books of art. And I remember being almost poleaxed by a book on surrealist art. And it's just something so extraordinary. I had never seen anything like this. It was, I remember, a book, I think it was a book of the paintings by a French surrealist called Yves Tanguy, and perhaps had personal reference, but his pictures are rather desolate and empty scenes with lonely figures, which is the teenage inner world, perhaps, or was mine. Anyway, there's this sort of door-opening experience, and reading Jung was another one of those kind of door-opening experiences that you don't get later in life so much. Or you do, but not so intensely, because you have so many doors open before. So that was the first encounter with anything psychoanalytic. It was Jung and his own autobiographical.
And then what about the relationship between the training in psychiatry? I think your own analysis and the point at which you decided to embark on that.
Pretty early on, I was, I spent a year between 66 and 67 at UCH, and then I spent another couple of years at Shenley Hospital, 67 to 68 or 9. Shenley Hospital was well known in those days as a fairly enlightened place, a lot of people trying to think a bit differently. See, this was the post-war period with the legacy of Second World War psychiatry, military psychiatry, where they'd experimented across the board with all sorts of things. And you know that psychoanalysis contributed a lot to that, the Northfield and beyond Fuchs had invented group therapy and so on. And one of the experiments at Shenley was known as Villa 10. And it's gone down in the history of psychiatry, probably gone down so far it's completely forgotten now. But it was run by a man called David Cooper, who set up this ward for male madman schizophrenics in a fairly liberated sort of way, where they could, you know, just engage with being, as it were, to a limited extent, but engage with being whatever it was they were. It had a strong existential philosophical background, so existentialism was very much in the air in those days. And I had read the book of Sartre's when I was at school, I'm proud to say. So, actually, there was the legacy. David Cooper had left by then, although it had been taken over by another man who kept it going. He was a gifted, rather strange man, Mike Conlon, who was a member of the Psychoanalytical Society, and who kept it going in a very admirable way, way into the 60s and 70s. There was a legacy when I went to Shenley, and at the time in the health service, psychiatry was introducing a peculiar phenomenon called a consultant psychotherapist, which was aimed to deal with, you know, that side of things. It was part of the anti-psychoanalytic ethos in psychiatry, that they thought that psychotherapy had to be a different animal. So there was this notion of a consultant psychotherapist was created. And Shenley got a consultant psychotherapist, a man called Sandy Bourne, who I found very congenial. He was a man full of ideas, and a very energetic man. I found engaging. So he perhaps was the first actual psychoanalyst I'd ever really met or had contact with, and I presented some of my mad cases to him, and he speculated in an energetic way about them, and I thought this was all very exciting and interesting. I suppose probably, and this would have been 68, late 68, that was when I suppose I decided I must do this. Because 68 was a significant year in...
This would have been a more inward turn than any were making at that particular point.
Well, yes.
Yeah.
Yes, absolutely. I was very interested in that whole movement of French student revolts. And so on. I had a friend who I went to medical school with, who was a peculiar mixture, being extremely conventional and very alternative. Because he had a conventional side to him, he was a bit organized, unlike the rest of us who were a bit alternative. And he set up a poetry publishing business, and after he qualified, he dropped out of medicine for a while and ran a publishing company called Fulcrum Press, which has a place in the history of poetry, I believe. And through him I knew, I was a bit in touch with the London scene. Things like the Arts Lab, it's called, in Soho somewhere, and the Compendium Bookshop, and there were various sort of centres which developed out of this alternative scene that was drug-related, and everybody was experimenting with being somebody different from who they were. So I had a sort of contact. I wasn't terribly involved with that because I was going on my medical career where I was spending every other night on duty and every other weekend. So I wasn't a lot of time for this. But I did keep in touch with this through this friend of mine, Stuart Montgomery, who went bankrupt with his poetry company and then quickly returned to medicine and also became a psychiatrist. Another one of those more gifted people who went through UCH and had a positive interest in psychiatry rather than ending up there because he wasn't any good at anything else. And sadly became terribly interested in scientific psychiatry and the workings of drugs on the neuronal synapses, and we rather lost touch with each other in the 80s, I suppose.
So you're saying you began personal analysis in like 1968?
Well, I began actually in 1969. Oh. I remember it was on the 5th of November, a nice revolutionary day, I thought, with Stanley Lee. A house which is a few houses up the street from here. A Kleinian analyst. I applied to the Institute for training before. In those days, you could apply before training. I was accepted conditionally on starting my analysis and my analyst seeing if I was complete lunatic, or if I was only sufficiently a lunatic to become a psychoanalyst.
And was it a choice over what kind of analysis you had? You were thinking of a Kleinian analysis at this point. How did you get to that?
Well, at that time, Kleinians were known to be good at analysing schizophrenics. So with my interest in psychiatry and my concern about psychiatry and the awful things that happen to these particularly vulnerable people, I was interested in Kleinian psychoanalysis, which at that time seemed as though it had the answer, had the key to understanding what schizophrenia was in experiential terms, as opposed to drugs, which worked on the neural synapses. Mm. So that's the simple levels.
Yeah. It's funny because actually, when I think it's in the clinical Kleinian, you use this term at one point, Kleinian fascination.
Mm-hmm.
And the way you're describing it now, however, is pretty much that, well, it wasn't something you thought too much about, because if you're interested in psychiatry, this was the direction you would go in, dealing with extreme emotional states.
Yes, yes. Yes, I suppose it was a fascination for Klein as well. Jung was I adore him, and his mysticism and the archetype of things. But when I read Klein, I thought, this is even more mysterious than Jung. This is for me. I was intrigued by this entry into a sort of psychic world which was so alien, it seemed, and perhaps so alien from my more, Chandler kind of background. This was part of feeling that I had to explore a different kind of existence from the dormitory suburb that I was brought up in. So yes, I was intrigued by Klein and this mysterious world of unconscious fantasy, as I now know to call it. At the time, it was these extraordinary notions of what people had in the back of their minds about their mothers and fathers and children and mother's tummy and all these sorts of things. It seemed a challenging world to make some sense of, and perhaps somebody here called Melanie Klein had made some sense of it.
Mm. Mm.
For some reason I was interested in mysteries of that kind. Now I suppose I know it was a mystery in there, and trying to sort myself out, which I think was a big element also of my going into psychiatry and into psychoanalysis. I wasn't very happy, at least teenage years, as a student. It took me 5 goes to pass my medical examination, which led me to the question, am I a real dunce or am I round the bend? It's got to be one of those, hasn't it? So I hoped it was that I was just round the bend, which might be curable.
Mm. Mm-hmm. So you're relating to a particular mystery in Kleinian
thought. might be appropriate for me, yes.
Where did when did the training take you after that then? What were you doing with it in your work?
Well, you see, when I'd been at Shenley, I then wanted to get a job in London, in the centre of London, so that I could go to analysis and go to the psychoanalytic training. So I got a job at a curious place called the Mulva Day Hospital, one of the places that had been an offshoot of Second World War psychiatry. A man there called Joshua Beerer, although he'd left by the time I went there, he wasn't at Northfield, but he'd worked a lot in social psychiatry in Runwell in the Second World War, and his big interest was social clubs, and that he'd set up a psychiatric day hospital which claimed possibly truly to be the first day treatment facility. He set this up straight after the First World War in the 1940s and it had become part of the National Health Service. So that had an interesting history in its own right. And I went there in the beginning of 1969, I suppose. When there was a sort of interregnum. Joshua Beerer had left, and it was right for sort of new people to come along and take over. I went there as a very junior psychiatrist, but there were a number of other people at the junior level, and it seemed to lack people at the senior level, because I think the health service was rather wondering what to do with this peculiar place. And hadn't really found somebody to fit into the role of the director of the aim and the position that Joshua Beerer had. So we took it over, a group of young people, another psychiatrist, a clinical psychologist, an occupational therapist, social worker, and we said this is going to be an egalitarian therapeutic community run on without hierarchy. So we said it was an interesting opportunity. I fell into the right place to experiment with anarchic ideas.
Yeah. How did the experiment work?
It was closed down 10 days later. I think it was an enormous therapeutic benefit for the staff. And we all had our own analysis and therapy. I think we probably did a lot for the people who came, the patients, we did call them patients actually, more in terms of our enthusiasm and interest than in terms of any really solid understanding of what we were doing or should be doing. I hope always been very respectful of that work by Truax and Kharkov, who say that the only thing about therapy is nothing to do with theories, it's all to do with, what is it, empathy, genuineness, and something of a positive regard. These are the three things a therapist has to have, and these are what make patients feel better. It's very cynical. I do think it has a lot to say, for I do think technique and ideas have a part to play as well, but I do think that that's an important aspect of it, and I think we got through a lot of the job that we did in the early 70s on the basis of that kind of pure enthusiasm, which, you know, made patients feel interested in those people.
And you describe yourself as having come from this sort of rather, you know, background appearance of rather over bureaucratized, and you presented this challenge and you wanted an organisation that wasn't like that in Melbourne.
Yeah.
I mean, how did it work then to try and have something that was more collective than...
How did it work?
Yes, how did it work in terms of not just the way the patients got from what you got from each other, but how did you make decisions? Did that work?
Well, yeah, I mean, I think we all had to learn a lot about decision making. About authority, yes, we did devolve decision making as much as possible, and in those days this was the ethos of the therapeutic community, what was called the flattening of the pyramid of authority, and as much as possible decisions were devolved to what we call community meetings or staff and patients, where, you know, decisions were made. They were real community meetings, not just where people complained about the bad food, but where decisions were made, including admissions actually, and quite a lot of influence over who and should be discharged and did go quite a long way towards a democratic principle, but not as far as a neighbouring day hospital called the Paddington Day Hospital, which also has a similar, it's a sort of sibling, he had rivalrous solidarity with the Paddington Day Hospital, run by a man called Julian Goodburn, which was pure anarchy, and has been written up. Claire Baron wrote a book called From Asylum to Anarchy, I think quite well known. We didn't go as far as that. We did work out lines of authority in the Mulberry Day Hospital. And I mean, I did learn quite a lot about that. Running a day hospital isn't like running an inpatient unit, where there is, in an inpatient unit, you can regulate people's lives. In a day hospital, you are always there in such a way that it invites them to come back the next morning, and if they don't like it, they don't. So that it's the need to involve people in a relational way rather than in this much more institutionalised way. So running a day hospital, you have to think much more about that engagement of the person as a person in the community. So those are some of the aspects of having runs. We thought a lot about decision making, we thought a lot about engagement of the people in the decision making, how far you could go towards a real democracy, and pulling back a little bit from the Paddington Day Hospital anarchy. I don't know which was better. That we understood, yeah, we learned something about authority, which I think Paddington Day Hospital didn't. And as you may know, Julian Goodburn, who set it up, was drummed out of the medical profession. I remember going to visit him on a boat in Chichester Harbour once, sort of licking his wounds and feeling being very unjustly treated.
So you're painting a very ambivalent feeling about bureaucracies. We know that preoccupation you're writing, the therapeutic coercion and all that. But you know, you went on then to have quite a sort of, you know, to become, as I said, you're a manager. You became a manager at a late point in your career.
Yes.
So how what were you able to bring to that from these sorts of earlier? I'm not thinking about the castle, but then we're also missing a gap there in between.
Yes, I spent 17 years running a psychotherapy service in Ealing. Started in the old St. Bernard's Hospital, one of the slowest to evolve into the 20th century, which I must say, you know, did accelerate its progress. It became quite a respectable place as far as...
So when you started, what do you describe what you came into?
Grim buildings, which had once been rather attractive Regency villas, well, it was more than a villa, Manchester, it was a palace. I think the first of the old LCC lunatic asylums, I think, built just before Free and Barney, Cunyash, as it was originally. Grim buildings, which were dirty, and they looked as depressed as these figures roaming the grounds, look derelict human beings. The system, you know, they were derelict human beings partly because the laundry system was that the laundry just did
as if I had a batch of clothes every week to a ward, irrespective. Ward staff sorted out, you know, which of these clothes fitted which of these people, and then they sent them back to the laundry the next week. So, you know, the systems were getting really ground to a halt. These places had had, you know, enormous morale in when they were built. I think it was 1831 that St. Bernard's was built. Its first medical superintendent was a man called Connolly, who was well known as an advanced thinker. His son-in-law was a man called Maudsley, who was responsible for setting up what 100 years ago was a very modern hospital in South London. Connolly was interested in his patients. These were places which provided wonderful facilities in the country. They were built outside London in the Green Belt because they thought that the country atmosphere would be good for the inmates. Long, you know, and this was before the days when they were isolated out there to get rid of them from proper society. And they had there was an attempt to provide a very congenial life for people who thought that they were going to spend all their lives there. Connolly was one of the people who developed what was called moral treatments, which the treatment was regarded as, you know, one of the main places where that had been pioneered in the late 18th century. Tuke, a man called Tuke at York, who was similar to Pinel, was it in Paris, who was thinking about these things. They used a lot of ideas from phrenology, and there was high morale, I think, in these places until the mid to late 19th century, by which time they were so overwhelmed with overcrowding that anything idealistic had to be forgotten about. And I went to St. Bernard's Hanwell Lunatic Asylum, as it was originally called. You know, and really at the end of that period, when demoralisation had set in and had been going for probably 100 years.
So what had to change? I mean, you know, you're talking about the laundry service and the basic issue about how to... What else had to change? What did you have to change in your room to work on?
Well, everything, I suppose. I didn't do it. I was very peripheral. As I say, about consultant psychotherapists, which is my role there, their role was to represent psychotherapy and to tolerate being as marginal as you can possibly be. So there were, at this time, before I went there were several of the new generation of psychiatrists who knew what Largactyl, lithium, ECT, and they were bringing in these new forms of treatment. And this was in the mid-70s when psychiatry was again quite high morale because of the enthusiasm for these new treatments, not along the lines that I was particularly interested in or felt very comfortable with. But there were a number of new psychiatrists coming in at that time who were the new booms. And this was the fresh air that needed to sweep through these musty old corridors. And they had a policy of rehabilitation to try to restore the people in the hospital to quite advanced, they became quite advanced in my times in the community psychiatry movement, if it's the right word. And I remember going to medical staff meetings, we had them monthly, and you know, one of the central things in the meeting was a report on how many beds had been taken down this month. And from about 2,500 at its peak, before I was there, it was coming way down, and eventually it was below 1,000. So that, you know, that was, you know, that's part of the way that you get an institution to focus on a hope and enthusiasm. You take a little thing like the number of beds that there are, the number of beds that have been taken down as a mark of the achievement. It was, you know, it was sort of a Tony Blair target kind of thing. But it had its, you know, it represented a new sense. We've got to do something about this place. And eventually, the big thing was the building of a purpose-built new psychiatric set of walls, quite separate from the old institution. And normally, these hospitals were moved, their admission walls were moved to the local general hospital. That was the normal, but this was different because St. Bernard's Hospital was actually within its own catchment area, and when they built the new general hospital, they put it on half of the grounds of the mental hospital, which was part of it too. That, you know,
not separated.
It was no longer separated, so that the mental hospital wasn't quite such, you know, a man relative out in the country. And then they built the psychiatric wing. It was still separate, but there was a psychiatric wing for the general hospital.
So you were there until when?
Till 93.
Looking at your writings, it's quite interesting to know what the kind of context of those is in terms of a life that goes into that thought. I mean, I guess where we are chronologically, I mean, it's interesting, you must have started the, you know, the publication was really starting to develop through the end of the period at St. Bernard's into the castle, I think. Is that right?
No, from my very first contact with psychiatry, not contact, first job as a psychiatrist when I went in 1966 to UCH, I thought I was going to write papers from that moment, and I taught myself a bit of statistics in order to do scientific work, because I thought that was the way you did it. And while I was a house officer, a senior house officer at UCH, I did write, I did do some research. Actually, it wasn't published until I got to Shenley. But I did some work on the birth order of schizophrenics, which came out in 1967. And in my complete ignorance, because I wasn't, you know, I didn't know about scientific publications or anything, I said, off to Nature, the top scientific journal. My first paper, my first draft of the paper, and they accepted it. And it wasn't a full paper, it was a, what they call a brief communication, just a couple of pages. So my first paper was actually published in Nature, and this was noticed by a man at Maudsley, who ran the MRC Epidemiology Unit, Elliot Slater, who was at the time editor of the British Journal of Psychiatry, an eminent psychiatric professor noted it and got hold of me and said, come on, you must do this research properly. And so he got me there. And I remember going there once a week to do this epidemiological research on birth order using a calculating machine which would work with a handle. This was in 1967, before pocket electronic calculators came in and doing factor analysis by the calculating machine and produced a more solid paper for the British Journal of Psychiatry on this minuscule topic.
But how do you get from there to, what is it, the late 1980s when the dictionary is published?
Well, it's
You know, from these more clinical sorts of papers into what by that period. I mean, that, the thing that we know the dictionary for is this extraordinary sort of backward grasp over the field. How did that happen?
I suppose in the same sort of muddled way. Does anyone plan their lives? Isn't it just something as it happens? You see, I was intrigued with the Kleinian ideas, and I read lots of stuff during my training, and I came out of my training in the mid-1970s at a time when there were a number of small groups in London setting up psychotherapy trainings. And one of these groups, the London Centre for Psychotherapy, came along and said, right, you know about Klein, teach it. And I, in my omnipotence, I'm a qualified psychoanalyst, so I'll teach it. Well, it is a different kettle of fish, as Audrey said about teaching. You know, when you really learn about things is when you start to teach them. It's not being a student, it's being a teacher, probably, would I agree. And they say in medicine that, you know, about doing an appendix, they say, see one, do one, teach one. That's how you learn. Anyway, and so I took that sort of principle and I read a paper by Clive and I'll teach it. But of course, the really interesting thing was get underneath what this really means about people. And so I read all through Klein, I suppose, and tried to teach it and got lots and lots of questions from intelligent students who didn't understand the thing that I was talking about. And, so I've got lots of questions, and they're always the best questions, aren't they? The students who don't know anything, and they ask the obvious questions, which, because you think you know everything, you don't answer.
This is a term, qualified by innocence, I think is a phrase you use.
I always say to my students, ignorance is your most important asset. And it comes from beyond this notion of the turning a beam of darkness onto a topic. I believe in that, yes. So anyway, the dictionary is the exact opposite. It's trying to shine a beam of light onto what Klein's ideas were about. So it came from my teaching, and then I was... I was in a little group with two or three other analysts. Arturo Barchevko was one of them, Alicia H. Goyen. And we had a little group to discuss, a reading group to discuss issues around psychoanalysis, philosophical issues. And we were hopeless. Because we didn't understand, you know, you want to understand some philosophy, so you go and read a book, and none of you understand it, so you don't know what you... So we got somebody in to help us with this somebody who thought would know about it, as a kind of tutor to the group, a man called Bob Young, who we picked up by accident in about 1984-83, who was, you know, he was a formidable scholar who just quarreled, I think, with the entire Cambridge University academia and left Cambridge and come to London because of his interest in psychoanalysis and to set up his publishing house and Free Association Books. So he was interested in us because we were a group of psychoanalysts, which was his interest, and we got him in to be a tutor for us. So there was a kind of exchange between this formidable academic scholar and our psychoanalytic knowledge and experience. Mm-hmm. And Bob Young, you see, from birth, I think, had an ambition to be a psychoanalyst and got waylaid into academia. And part of his reason for leaving Cambridge was because he wanted to be a psychoanalyst, by which time he was too old really to train. So he did it, this was in the early to mid 80s, when you could still have your analysis, see some patients under supervision, and, you know, put up your brass plate as a psychotherapist, which is what he did. But the patients that he saw under supervision to learn the trade, he came to me and my department at St. Bernard's to learn that. So we had this reciprocal arrangement. He taught me how to read a philosophy book, he taught me to be an academic insofar as I am. I taught him to be a psychotherapist insofar as he is. So we had a very mutually fruitful.
Was it out of that then the suggestion came that you should write a book on Kleinian theory?
Yes, yes. At that time in the mid 80s, there was a European group called the International Network for Psychoanalysts, which was a group of very politically committed people in Italy, Germany, Switzerland, around Paul Parin and, what was his name, Morgenthaler, is it? People who had been terribly interested in, and went to Africa to take an interest in tribes in Africa to see, you know, to try to understand psychodynamic processes in the minds of people who come from extremely different cultures. But anyway, it was a very alternative, very radical Marxist as well. And somehow Bob Young worked me into going off on one of these things. And I remember it was in the airport in Zurich or somewhere, on the way back, he said, what we really need is a book, a dictionary on Klein, what all these words mean. He said, would you like to write it? And I said, oh yes, I've just been thinking of doing the same thing. All these students I've been teaching, and we've been trying to find out what these words mean. So that was the germ of the idea. And then I went away and read. I had a little cottage in the country and I went away for 2 weeks to read Melanie Klein from beginning to end to try and find out what the words did mean, which was then the basis for writing the dictionary, which I suppose took a couple of years from there on.
what strikes me is that sometimes your framing of Klein gives more meaning to it than Klein herself might have been able to produce. And so it's a very odd experience, because in a sense that one would say that then that's a theoretical development of your own, but it's backward facing. And I think that's a very interesting way of working.
But isn't that the way, academia works anyway, that people look at primary sources and develop them and the original known more important.
But I would say that you're interested in history, you're interested in history, you're interested in tracing the genealogy of theory is actually distinctive.
Is it?
I mean, some people try and make a reference point, but they're jumping off somewhere else. And the reference point's quite slender in the way that Klein would have done with Freud and so on. You know, there's an engagement. This is a much deeper engagement with history.
It's exposition. I always saw it as exposition of the ideas. I remember saying to Bob Young once, well, I've written a dictionary, but it's not creative, it's just other ideas. And he said, oh, but it's creative to be able to produce an exposition. Which is hard. I didn't think it was really very creative. It's solid, hard slog, which was something I was taught by my father, who went out through all the grades of the civil service on the basis of sheer daily slog of doing his bureaucracy.
I suppose there's something about an encyclopedia that's quite categorical too.
Yes. Yes. So for all my rebellion in my teens and romancing with anarchy in the therapeutic community, I have my father in me to thank for being able to make some mediation with that, you know, my own background.
Yeah.
Perhaps it's I have to thank my analysis for being able to help me to come to terms with two warring sides of my personality. Maybe.
I want to talk to you about the way in which the dictionary and clinical Klein someone has been read. And you talked about, you know, in your mind was your students, who were students, they would become psychotherapists. But it strikes me now that many people reading the dictionary will never become, psychotherapists or psychoanalysts. They're coming from other disciplines to get a handle on Klein. And I suppose that leads us into the change in your own life, in the later 90s after the castle, when your academic interests became, more central. So I suppose that first of all there'd be a question about, if I think about, I'm someone myself who doesn't, there's no clinical applications, as a historian, how might those sorts of ideas have relevance? And you, and university, since you've been at Essex since 1997, you're surrounded by people who might be rather similar to me, who not necessarily having clinical careers. And in fact, one of the things that's interesting about the centre is that it doesn't have a direct it's offering something else.
Yes.
So I suppose I'm wondering, there are questions about where the field itself is heading.
Yes.
And about the different ways in which your work might fit within that now.
Yes. Well, yes, I left St. Burns in 1993 to go to the castle, which was probably a mistake. Was that, is it called? I think that's the castle for me. I had a management stroke clinical job and I didn't like, I went there because I was curious about management and is it possible to make, to develop a kind of management which is congenial to the understanding of human beings, particularly in the way that psychoanalysts might understand them. And I thought the castle might be a place where that would be possible. But the movements within the health service, I think, were in the opposite direction. And I decided that the job that I had needed to be split, really, to somebody who was a clinical lead and somebody who was a business lead. And the castle people and the NHS authorities were completely in disagreement with that. And they said, oh well, you don't need to stay any longer. So I wasn't exactly sacked because I was coming up from retirement at 60 anyway. But was also, yes, there was also the fact that the centre at the university was advertising professorship, and I thought that might be nice for my retirement. So I wanted to go more part-time and just be this clinical lead. And this is why they said, no, well, we don't want it like that. We want the clinical lead and the business lead to be one and to inform each other. And I thought it wasn't possible. So I left on those, on that basis. They were very agreeable to me leaving. Well, they told me to go, and I was very agreeable to go, whichever way it was.
So, what was the transition like for university from the NHS and the castle?
It was wonderful. Now, you're from university, Mike, and you think that the bureaucracy in the university is terrible, but I can tell you, going from the health service to the university in 1997, it was wonderful. And of course, the university now is somewhere like the health service was
in 1977.
Yes, but at the time it was very different, and the sense of the being a job to do, that it was teaching, bringing on new minds, new thoughts, new ideas, and so on, was really alive. I mean, I think it was less alive than it might have been years ago, but compared to the health services, it really was. And of course, the centre was a very new centre, so it had that kind of all growing up together with a new project and something which was not happening really very much in other universities.
Although more so now. Or in recent years, I think, as distinctive as it was.
It's not as distinctive.
Yeah, there are more, I think there's been a general development across the UK of
maybe
something to fly this.
I don't know. There are other centres, but there were others. There's been lots of other centres. It's closed down as well, like Brunel or Canterbury or places. I don't know, it seems. Maybe there's a kind of turnover.
Now there might be things like psychosocial studies which crop up.
So I don't know if it was the beginning of a trend. I think there was a sense in the 1990s that something like psychoanalytic studies or psychosocial studies were a big thing that was on the move. And I don't think it's moved as much as we thought it would. It sort of comes and goes a bit. That's my perception. And the centre is one of the places that has lasted now for 15, getting off 20 years, I think. It's probably quite a long time. UCL, maybe longer, that centre there. Coming to the centre, that was the sort of atmosphere. And I had, I had an academic interest. I had published a dictionary, and I got a sense from the response to the dictionary that I could do something creditable as a bit of an academic and a bit of a scholar. So it was very interesting to take on courses and to teach them. psychoanalytic method of gaining knowledge. It was more epistemology than psychoanalytic methodology.
Well,
and that was very interesting.
I mean, it takes the English, the thing which, because I'm interested in, which is that you're coming to that place with an awful lot of clinical knowledge, but you're in a situation where you're not teaching people who will be clinicians. And so it throws up that question about the way in which psychoanalytic ideas can be used outside the consulting room, and how, what some of the issues are with that. And I did notice a recent publication which I haven't read and I'd like to read, which is about social science, marriage, or infection. So, you know, I guess I'm wondering about your experience now in this position where, you know, you're relating to a wide range of other disciplines, and
yes,
you're in this center. With people who are also interested in the history of psychoanalysis and so on, but in which the therapeutic ambition isn't necessarily the point, or if it is, it may not be psychoanalytic.
Mm.
And
one of the,
what that means about your engagement. Yeah. Mm.
One of my experiences of coming to the university was, it wasn't that I started an engagement with social science, say, because I've been interested in that for a very long time. You see, the whole therapeutic community thing is about how does one develop social entities which are therapeutic.
Mm-hmm.
The big question asked by Tom Main, who set up the Castle Hospital as a therapeutic community, and was my predecessor at the Castle Hospital, you know, what can be therapeutic about a mental health organisation? I read quite a lot of social science in my amateur way and tried to think about it and write about it within the therapeutic milieu. What the impact of coming to the university was that I met real social scientists like you and other people and began to think, well, I don't know if I really have got much of a handle on the possibilities of psychoanalysis and social science making a marriage. And, you know, the idea of infection or marriage goes back to the Malinowski encounter with psychoanalysis and Ernest Jones, where he said psychoanalysis is infecting neighbouring disciplines like anthropology. I spent a lot of time, I think, since going to the university, thinking about how does psychoanalysis engage with other disciplines in a way which isn't patronizing of other disciplines, in the way that I think psychoanalysis has often done. Particularly with social science, or doesn't
patronizing because,
well, it's like Ernest Jones' response to Malinowski, when Malinowski says the Trobriand Islanders don't have that leaderless complex. Ernest Jones said, "Well, yeah, you just don't understand. You don't know about the unconscious. If you really understood the unconscious, you'd see that they've actually got a kind of." It was complex, maybe slightly different form, slightly different, but it's the same. We analysts understand these things better than you people because you don't have the opportunity. That's what I read into Ernest Jones, maybe reasonably, but there's something of that quality. Perhaps I exaggerate, he did have quite a respect for social science, and was it the British Sociological Society? He set up joint lectures with the Sociological Society before the First World War, or sometime around that time. I think before the First World War. He's really engaging psychoanalysis with the wider world. And I don't know if we do it any better now than he contributed very much to sort of marital understanding or marital contract between the two. And I suppose I moved away a bit from social science and I got very interested in the history of psychoanalysis, and in history is finding its place within cultural history in general, in Britain particularly, and much about other countries. I wrote a paper on the way in which Freud had been read by various cultural locations in Britain between the 1890s and the 1920s, which interested me enormously. You know, why did people in those days take an interest in these crazy ideas? Mm.
And of course, one of the things I'm thinking about, something you said yourself, I think, in clinical clients, that those were presumably different questions than we now ask all the patients present with different symptoms and so on.
Yes. That was something it struck me in clinical clients. If you see new patients, you ask new questions, so you end up new theories, mm-hmm. and then you have the problem of how they connect with the old mm-hmm. theories. Mm-hmm. But yes, you're right. The history came out of the dictionary and clinical clown because there's something strange went on in the 1920s. Because at the time, Ernest Jones set up the British Society with people who came from the most influential sectors of British society and intellectual life, and he had a whole raft of upper middle class and semi-aristocratic and Bloomsbury-related people, section of society which tended to be enormously highly educated, slightly anti-Semitic perhaps, and then they embraced this middle European, uneducated Jewish woman who became the darling of their hearts. For a whole 10 years, Melanie Klein was the focus of the society's research and its sense of pushing psychoanalysis forward, mm-hmm. you know, beyond Freud. Mm-hmm. How did this happen? How? I haven't understood. You tell me why. So this is what interested me in how did psychoanalysis take root in British society, because it came out of the question of what sort of society was the psychoanalytical society that got formed from these roots, which would then embrace something so apparently on the surface alien. So then I became interested in the roots of psychoanalysis in this country. Who picked it up first, and why did they pick it up? What did they do with it? And then I delved a bit into the archives of the Wellcome Museum and Melanie Klein's papers, and I dug out some interesting archival material which got published. So that was my interest in history. Feel it's been a bit more successful than my interest in social science.
Mm. Because also I know that you're working on beyond work with Fuchs and the whole group tradition and so on. So those historical interests then are more central than they were. Mm.
Yes, because the other strand of my interest in history is the Second World War and psychiatry in the Second World War. And what came out of the Second World War for British psychiatry, which was partly the therapeutic community which I was involved in my own lifetime, and group therapy which I also practiced quite a bit of in the past. So was a key period when British psychiatry suddenly flowered, and I was working in the kind of fallout of that period of enormous fertility in British psychiatry. So yes, I did. I became very interested in that, and I wrote forward to Tom Harrison's book on Northfield as a sort of mark of my interest and respect for all that work that they did at Northfield.
One of the things that strikes me is actually, you know, there's a very wide range to your work, and you've got there's an ethical part too, because of the issues around, you know, therapy, coercion, group, tradition, and Klein. And where are you going now?
Well, just about history. I suppose it's easier to take an interest in history and psychoanalysis, because one can think about the history of psychoanalysis rather than telling historians how to do history with psychoanalytic ideas. So it's easier to sort of plot a historical story of psychoanalysis in that way.
But on that score, that's interesting, because it seems to me that the questions about what one could do historically with psychoanalytic ideas is one that's not been asked that much about since the criticism of psychohistory, which became resounding, and the question about what sort of uses are possible now is one that I think needs more thought.
Yes. I'm sure we're better historians, and you will know very well than me to know about how to use psychoanalytic ideas, but you yourself are using ideas of transference and counter-transference even in your own historical work. But where am I now? I suppose, I've got a project that I'm hopefully coming to a completion of, which comes out of the epistemological course, the methodology course that I ran for over 10 years at Essex, and how do you get reliable knowledge out of the clinical psychoanalytic situation? How do we know that psychoanalytic knowledge is knowledge? It's all this question, really. And I am very interested in that, because it's the very basis of psychoanalytic knowledge, where the knowledge comes from. And this is the problem with a psychoanalytic studies center, is that it is remote from the setting that generates the knowledge, and I'm rather concerned that something like the Psychoanalytic Studies Centre of Essex doesn't get too far removed from that, and that the people who are working there, researching there, teaching there, do have a solid understanding of clinical work. I think you have to know how the knowledge is produced in order to be able to teach it best.
And that means you have to be a clinician.
Well, I think so, yes. I mean, you can be an analyst and perhaps, but I think you have to be a clinician, really. But I think there are a lot of people in the centre who think that's not true. And it may be so. It may be that we now have come to a position in the development of psychoanalysis where we've got enough knowledge, or we've got more or less all the knowledge we're going to get, and that what needs doing is And maybe that is best done in the academic setting. Mm-hmm. You know, less speculation about the possible future. It might be that we've got to study what we've already generated from the psychoanalytic setting. I'm not sure about that, because I think even if we do say, if we put a moratorium on everybody producing a new idea, which has been the problem with psychoanalysis since Freud died, actually. Since Freud died, there's been nobody to say you can't hold that idea. So everybody holds all sorts of ideas. And we need some way of understanding which are the better ones, which are the more valid ones, where what the inconsistencies are, and to consolidate the body of knowledge. I still think that's where we might be now. And then the question, it's connected with what you're asking, all is, where do we do that work? Do we do it in seminar rooms in a university, or do we still do it in a clinical setting? And I think we still study clinical. If the job now is to compare, you know, ideas about counter-transference in Britain with ideas about intersubjectivity in the United States, do we just talk about the semantic definitions and their ramifications and intertwining and stuff, or do we go back to the clinical setting and test out, find how to do the comparisons in the clinical work? I think we probably should stick with the clinical work, but I don't know that for sure. Anyway, that's what my project at the moment is can we use the clinical setting not to generate any more bloody ideas, but how to consolidate what we've got? That's the future.
That's the future.